Good morning, viewers. We begin our today's FB live, and warm greetings from team Banjara. Any topic relating to children, regarding children, connected to children, is very close to our heart, and hence we will be bringing two sessions back to back, in the sense this Saturday, today, and the next Saturday, both will be connected to children and some topics which are we feel of concern, needs to be introspected. So what we will be covering today is the long term effects of lockdown, and the next week is going to be the emotional and special needs of children. Bringing this talk to you is Dr. Ali Khwaja. He is the chairman and founder of Banjara Academy, TEDx speaker, mentor, guide, counselor. So over to Dr. Ali.
Very good morning to all of you. Welcome back again in this series of webinars every Saturday, 11 o'clock. Ask anybody who has got grown-up children. Ask them, how was this process of bringing up your children, giving them an education, giving them an upbringing? And they'll say, I don't know how the time passed. Whom I still remember, my kid was so small and he used to come running to me for everything. And before you know it, my child is already grown up, he's flown out of the nest and he's become so big and things of that sort. That is exactly what happens. Children are a need of today to prepare them for tomorrow. That is why today I want to discuss with all of you. What are your plans? What is your thinking? What is the type of, efforts that you are making towards the long-term benefits, goals, etc. of your child? You may have a child who is 2 years old, you may have a child who is 16 years old, it doesn't matter. Can we spend some time looking at the long-term effects or goals of the child? I'll tell you the reason also why we are discussing this, because all discussions that are taking place around me, all the counselees or friends who are coming in contact and asking for some guidance or discussions and all that, they are talking about today what to do. Should I send my child to school or not? Should I hold him back for 1 month? Should I hold him back for 1 year? Should I do this? Should I do that? How is online classes taking place? How many hours they should be? Yes, I know that it is a need of the day. With the lockdown and things of that sort, we have to create alternatives to ensure that your child's education continues, and I'm glad that you are doing that. But that, as I said, is only the immediate need. You don't look at the immediate need of your child and say, has he done his homework today, or has he put on his uniform, then it is fine. You also start thinking, where is my child headed? Is he getting a proper education? Is his learning proper? Is he going in the right direction? Where are is he going to be eventually? And things of that sort, right? So that brings me to one question, which I have been battling with since a long time, much, much before all this COVID and lockdown and all that came. And that is, how do we define education? And our children getting the right form of learning, education, and overall development. As you know, we all keep remembering that thousands of years back we had the Gurukul system, which was completely different from what our children are going through. It had tremendous merits. It just fizzled off, not because it was not good, but because the British came in and brought in the Macaulay system of education, and they were the rulers for 200 years. We had no choice, we had to follow whatever they had to say. Once that was done, and 70 years after the British have gone away, what are we doing now in terms of ensuring that we give the right education, learning, upbringing, and development to today's child, the 21st century child? We have still not broken through the shackles of the chalk and talk method, except that we don't use the chalk, we use probably the mouse or whatever it is. But primarily, even now, it is the chalk and talk method, meaning to say that the teacher decides, this is the portion, this is the syllabus, this is the textbook, and the teacher goes on conveying data and information to the child. And the child is supposed to absorb that, take down notes, revise, review, mug up, put it down in the examination, and that's it, the child has passed. And that is why you will see, while innumerable parents have protested against the reopening of school, I don't find anybody protesting against holding of exams, which are starting right from now. 18th of June is our PUC exam. 24th, we are starting. 8.5 lakh children will be attending SSLC exams, and then one after another. The entire calendar of July is filled with nothing but exams. And all those exams require the child to go out and go to an unknown place, interact with unknown people, give that exam, and come back. So why are we so focused on examinations, on certification, on degrees and diplomas? Is that what is our intention? I can understand parents who 30 years back said that yes, that is the intention, because unless my child gets a proper degree, diploma, whatever it is, he will not be able to earn. Ladies and gentlemen, you are well aware today that those degrees and diplomas have receded into the background. Your earning capacity of the child, the career of the child, the future of the child, the degrees and diplomas will play a very minor role in that. It is the overall abilities of your child which will determine how well he will do, even financially or, you know, career wise. So if you accept that, let us see what is the need of the 21st century child. As I said, the lockdown came in. The government is still not yet decided whether to reopen schools at all, and if so, when to reopen, whether to reopen only for higher classes, lower classes. We will leave that to the government. We have an elected government, so we will abide by whatever the rules and regulation the government lays down in all its wisdom. The second thing is, there are parents who are saying, even if the government reopens schools, I am not going to send my child. Yes, as a parent, you have a right. You want to protect your child, and you feel that it is dangerous for the child to go to school. It's your prerogative. You are taking a decision, and I respect the decision of all those parents who say, I may not agree with them, but I respect their decision that they would not like to send their children to school. But what I want to ask is learning, is development, is growth primarily going to be decided whether your child attends classes either on screen or in person, takes in that information and reproduces it? Is that what we call as the future of the child? No. Obviously no. It is far beyond that. It has been more than 30 years that our Howard Gardner, Professor Howard Gardner of Harvard University, came out with the concept of multiple intelligences. 10 years later, Daniel Goleman introduced the layman to the concept of emotional intelligence. Somewhere in the 90s, World Health Organization listed out 10 basic life skills which are required for any child to grow up and become a successful adult. All this has been with us for 20, 30 years. I am still wondering why we are not waking up to it. For example, when this very animated debate is going on between parents, teachers, government and all that, whether to physically send a child to school or whether to make him sit at home and go through the learning through the screen, we are only talking subjects. We are only talking English, Kannada, science, math, social studies. We are not talking life skills. Let me start with perhaps one of the most basic life skills that a child needs. A child is an active, energetic, bubbly little human being who is growing up. He needs physical activity. Now, are we providing that? Many of us selected schools which have very good sports facilities, yoga, this, that, because we said, I want my child to have a holistic development, so this school is providing this, so therefore I'm sending my child there. But if I am now going to not allow that child to go there, he will be deprived of his swimming, his football field, his badminton, his yoga, whatever physical exercises that he used to do in school. Okay, doesn't matter. School is not the only place where the child can do it. Do you have alternative facilities? Are you sending or are you willing to send your child out to get some physical activity or not? If not, if you say, no, I live in a condominium where there is no such facility and I do not want to take the risk of sending my child out to a club or some other place, fair enough. But do you realize the long-term effect? A child who is bottled up in a 2 BHK, 3 BHK, whatever you are living in, and does not have a regular facility of going out and indulging in physical activity, is going to become a very restless child. He is going to become hyperactive. There was this pandemic of ADHD, attention deficit hyperactive disorder. You'll be amazed at the number of children in the next 1 or 2 or 3 years who are going to be put that label of ADHD, because parents will say, my child is not only hyperactive, he is throwing things, he is breaking things, he is not sitting for 1 minute, he is refusing to sit in front of the laptop. They'll take him to doctors and doctors will say, yes, this is hyperactivity, has to be brought down. They'll put him on medication. These are not the type of things that we should expose our child to, no? So ask yourself, whether you want to send your child to school or not is secondary. Are you giving enough physical outlets to your child? And if you are not doing that, there are two disadvantages. One is the child's physical growth will stop. The child has no physical activity, he is not playing any games, he is not into athletics, he is not into exercise or anything of that sort. So how do you expect his body to grow? How do you expect his bones to strengthen? How do you expect his muscles to grow? That is all. The second thing is, as you are well aware, the sports activities and this and that are not restricted to physical things. Participating in games helps him team spirit. It brings in leadership, who's going to be the captain, etc. It brings in obedience. When the coach is blowing the whistle and saying, you do this and you move out of the field or something, you have to listen to them. It sharpens your senses, that from the corner of the eye you see the ball coming and you should be able to sense it and move fast. It develops the kinesthetic ability of the child to respond. The body should respond fast to the mind. It also helps the child to understand things like disappointment. You know how many children aspire to get into a particular team, but in the last moment they are not selected. Yes, they cry, they are upset, but they are learning a lot about life, about failure. Or rather, we have to tell them that not getting selected is not a failure. It is just that you did not get selected into that. Life goes on with that. And the third aspect of not allowing a child sufficient physical activity is what I mentioned to you, that your child may get, I'm not saying every child will do it, I hope your child doesn't, but there is a possibility that your child will become restless, irritated, hyperactive, he'll start throwing tantrums, he'll start doing all those type of things. Are you, willing to give in to that? Now that brings me back into the cognitive thinking of the child. The same way as the body has to keep growing, the mind has to keep growing. It is the first few years of life where the mind develops maximum. As an adult, even if you put in a lot of efforts and do a lot of things, your mind doesn't develop, grow, evolve as much as it does if you are in your growing up and your childhood and adolescent stage. So we come to what is referred to as social and emotional learning. Every child needs to have social and emotional learning. And unfortunately, the Macaulay system of education does not include social and emotional learning. I'll give you a simple example. Children have a break, they go out. One bully comes and he snatches the ball and he doesn't allow the other kid to play, and the other one is crying and is extremely upset. He comes crying into the class. The bell rings. The teacher is about to start. the class so that the portion can be completed. And here is this kid crying away to glory. The teacher asks, what happened?
Ma'am, the towel took away my ball. Ma'am, the towel is not.
Don't cry like a baby. So what if he has taken a ball? Go sit down. I'm starting the history class. Don't waste time. Now, what are we doing? We are not only, teaching the child social and emotional learning, we are suppressing it. You have no right to cry, you have no right to complain, you have no right to feel that way. Sit and mug up whatever the teacher is teaching you. Now, whether that is being done on the screen or whether that is being done in person, the emotions remain the same. As it is, I told you that by locking in a child, we are depriving the child of social learning. All types of social learning. Bullying is only one of them. Teamwork. Peer ganging up and peer pressure, as we keep complaining about children. Peer pressure can be bad, but in a lot of cases, peer pressure is good. It is excellent. It helps children to evolve. So we should look at both angles of the thing. That the child, I hope you are all aware of the fact that we human beings are what are known as primates. We belong to the category of living beings who are called primates. What are primates? Primates are monkeys, apes, orangutans, gorillas, and human beings. All primates, you can ask anybody who is an anthropologist or a zoologist, all primates are social animals. They thrive on social interaction. Primates cannot live alone, cannot survive alone. Now, am I doing justice to my child by depriving him of his social interactions? Just because I am scared that he might get this virus or whatever it is. How am I going to ensure that my child will have sufficient social interactions? Yeah, some people have already said, yeah, I am allowing him to talk to his friends, make video calls. I even tell him, call up Ajji who is sitting in the village and talk to her also and do this. And so he's getting a social interaction. Sorry, I beg to differ. The human touch of social interaction is very, very, very different from what you do through electronic media. Starting from how a person enters, in what direction is he looking, what is his style of walking, whom does he wish first and whom does he not wish, does he have a plastic smile or is it a genuine smile, whom is he giving more attention to, is he making some sarcastic remarks? And are those remarks focused on me? Do I need to feel bad about these sarcastic remarks or is it something in general? All these things come under the ambit of what we refer to as social interaction, social learning. Children thrive on that. When they grow up, they will have to face a lot of people. They may have a very nasty boss. They may have a colleague who is jealous of them. They may have a customer who is purposely making life difficult for him. All these things are going to be as important as his technical skills or his domain specialization that we call it. If he is very competent in whatever he does, but he does not have social skills, he is not going to be able to manage and be successful. So now that this lockdown has taken away the basic social interactions that all children had the facility of, they could run around, they could meet their friends, they could, in school they had so many opportunities of doing something, even in the school bus they would be chatting away, somebody would be hitting somebody, somebody would be throwing a paper plane, somebody would be sharing a chocolate, somebody would be snatching a chocolate. All these things the children have been denied of. What is going to be the long-term impact? We have to see that. The other area that we are going to be confronted with is boredom. Children love variety. The lockdown has taken away a lot of choices from the children. There may be a child who doesn't even want to play, but he just wants to go down and sit in one corner and watch the other children in the building playing. He observes, he understands, he giggles and laughs to himself, he makes some comments. He sees what those children are doing. He finds one new child has come and his behavior is different from the others who have already been there. He is learning and his mind is getting stimulated. You may think that what did your child do? He just went and sat quietly for 1 hour, he didn't even play and he came back. But believe me, that is also learning. That is also a stimulation of his mind. Now, if we are going to deprive the child of that, what are the alternative activities that we are offering to the child? The child wants variety. The child wants mental stimulation. Are you going to provide that, or the child is going to get bored? And I come back to what I had told you. He is going to get short-tempered, he is going to get irritable, he is going to get hyperactive, he is going to throw tantrums. And then you will wonder how to get prevention is better than cure. I'm sure you all agree on that. So what are we doing in terms of prevention? How do you understand that a child needs to be provided all these things? I mentioned social and emotional learning. Yeah, Sudha said giggling with friends, sharing personal talk regarding their parents is also missed. Yeah, because parents are now have become not helicopter parents but drone parents. They are there all over the place. When the classes are going on, there's a parent watching them. If they're talking to their friends, they're watching them. If they're eating food, they're watching them. And indeed, Sudha, I agree with you that simple thing like talking to their friends and gossiping about parents. Hey, you know what my mom does? And yeah, you keep quiet, man. My mom and my mom is the greatest monster mom in the whole world and something. By saying that, he is bringing out his pent up emotions. And that is what is needed. He will not hate his mom. He will not do anything provided he has that emotional outlet. And that is what I was coming to when Sudha pointed out this giggling with friends, sharing personal talk and things of that sort. That there's a thing called emotional development and emotional learning. What are we doing with regard to that? After Daniel Goleman in 1995 came out with the concept of emotional intelligence. It existed even before that, but it didn't come to the common man's level till he brought out this book called Emotional Intelligence. And then everybody woke up and they started thinking about it. Now, emotional intelligence rests on basically five pillars. Yes, Reena, I agree with you. Spiritual life is very important too. So if you want to inculcate certain values, I would not even say spirituality, I would say values, morals, regardless of whether you are a religious person and whether you are into rituals or not. But the basic values, morals and all these things are equally important. How will the child learn that? The child goes to school, finds that in the next class there was a child who stole something from his friend's bag and then he got caught and then he was punished and all the others were laughing at him and he was crying or he was hitting somebody or whatever it is. Now that makes this child question himself. Yeah, that time when I saw that fellow with that wonderful eraser or something of that sort, I also got tempted, but I didn't take it because I know that this is wrong. That is what I want you to understand, that the child needs that type of, you know, the building up of value systems, of morals, of principles, leading on to spirituality or religious behavior and all that, that's your prerogative if you have that bent of mind. But the basics of that is definitely important. So coming back to emotional intelligence, as I was telling you, emotional intelligence rests on five very simple pillars. I'm sure many of you know it, but I'll quickly repeat them. Self-awareness, number one. Being aware of your own self, who am I, what are my likes and dislikes, what makes me happy, what makes me sad and those sort of things. Yes, Leela, I'm coming to that. Self-awareness. Once I become aware, then comes the next one, which Leela pointed out just now. Managing my own emotions. I am angry, how do I bring out my anger? I am jealous, how do I manage my jealousy? I am excited, how do I control my excitement? Each of these emotions, each of these attitudes, each of these things, the second pillar helps, that is management of emotions. The third pillar is motivation. What makes me motivated to do something? And motivation to studies is perhaps way down in the priority list of children. So can we do something? Can we take advantage of this lockdown period to help a child understand the significance of learning? Motivate the child that your learning is going to make a better human being, is going to make you happier, it's going to make you successful. There's so many things that you're going to gain by learning, not just for the sake of getting marks or not just for the sake of getting admission in a good college and things like that. So the third pillar of emotional intelligence is motivation. We have to help children continue to remain motivated to do whatever is good for them. The fourth is empathy, putting yourself in the other person's shoes. Are we helping our child to understand others? I know of children who make very nasty remarks. Why did that teacher do this? Why did dad do that? Why is this happening? Why are they not allowing us to go to school or to swim or to do this or that? Somewhere, if that child can be taught empathy to help to understand, put yourself in the other person's shoes and think what must be going on in that person's mind. That is what we need to teach a child. It takes a lot of effort and time, but it's a wonderful asset, the fourth pillar of emotional intelligence, that is empathy. The fifth and last pillar is a culmination of these four, social skills. To be able to help the child get along with his best friend, with another guy whom he doesn't like, with a third chap who bullies him, with a fourth chap who is ignoring him completely but he wants to make friends with him, with that pretty girl in the class whose attention he is trying to gain but she is not even looking in his direction, with his mom, dad, ajji, tata, grandfather, grandmother, with that nasty uncle who comes and always makes remarks against him. All these, to be able to handle all these people, is what is known as social skills. So in a nutshell, that is what social and emotional learning is all about. How do we go about it? How do we look at the long-term perspective of, you know, developing children? Yes, Jayashree, I agree that emotional intelligence starts from home. That's why I'm talking to you people, that it has to start from home, because children are at home now 24/7. That is what is needed. Moral values. Yes, Vanita, I agree with you. That's what I was telling. Morals, values, principles, spirituality, give it any name. But it is, absolutely essential. Okay. So now what we will do is that we will throw it open for questions, which you can put in to the text. And as I scroll, I will be able to get that. But as they say in all the TV serials, that will be done after the break. Now here the break is not going to try to sell some product to you or no jingle. I would like Purnima, our director, to just give you a quick update on what we are doing towards this and what is our contribution and how we can help you if, in case you need help. So can I pass it on to Purnima and then I'll come back in a couple of minutes.
Thank you, Ali. So back here with each one of you, and you can please feel free to put in your questions, any clarifications, so that we can answer it right on this platform for the benefit of you and also for the benefit of our other viewers who will be here online with all of us. So as far as the Banjara is concerned, anything which is, you know, relating to children is very close to our heart. And we would step up to, be with you in whatever way you think that we can be of help to you. It could be with regarding to even the most minor issues, does not matter. Anything which bothers you as a significant adult, as a caretaker, caregiver, And if you think that it may possibly make the situations a little dysfunctional, or it may, you know, disturb the harmony, please feel free to get in touch with us. We have a wonderful place called Banjara's Gurukul. They deal with all different aspects of children, and our team is also a very fabulous team. They work with all their heart at Gurukul, at our office. I mean, we're all in the same premise. So when we say children, it's not just the infants or the school going ones. We mean right from infants to adolescents. So even an adolescent is a child for us. Yeah, they don't like it. They like to be called as young boys and girls. But nonetheless, anything which is even relating to, you know, adolescent, their tantrums, their anger issues or their study issues. And, you know, there could be so many things which we feel that, oh my God, he was better when he was young. So why is he being, you know, so nasty now, or why is he arguing with me so much now? So it could be relating to emotional issues, it could be relating to social issues, or it could be relating to his career also. So what we do at the academy is that anything which is relating to counseling is totally free at the academy. You can feel free to come down as many times. You can come down as a parent. If you think that, you know, you would like to check where you can tweak things and make it better for yourself and for your family members, of course, you can also get children along. And another thing which happens is that sometimes, just now when Dr. Ali was mentioning that, you know, so many exams are coming around the corner and they are going to be perturbed. And suddenly, you know, with the lockdown, they thought that things were a little easy, but suddenly so many things are going to come up and they will have so much on their plate. If they have any kind of an exam anxiety, what do I do? Where do I study? Why do I study? What do I study? You know, how do I study? All these questions come up in the minds, and which is very appropriate also for them to think. But then there are answers to that also. And if they have any issues with regarding to study skills also, academy is also offered free. We have wonderful set of counselors. And regular training is offered to, you know, every counselor at the academy by Dr. Ali. So we are, you know, regularly having workshops, training sessions by him to also help children out, adolescents out, to help parents out, teachers out, schools out. So that is the range with which we keep working very regularly. So feel free to come down, to call us up or to write to us. We will be putting our email IDs in the chat box just in a short while from now. Go ahead and feel free. We will be more than happy if you are comfortable with yourself, with your family members, and with your loved ones, more so the children. That is the topic today. And as I mentioned earlier, we will be taking this in two parts. So today what Dr. Ali is going to be speaking to you about is going to be the long-term effects of lockdown. So what we look at is, okay, are the worksheets ready? Has the school given us the books? Do we need to pay the fees, the van fees? All those things are what is immediate. But he is also taking you many steps further down the line into the emotional development and the social development, the learnings they get, and what role we can play in their emotional intelligence in developing, right? So taking you further and, you know, ready to answer more questions is Dr. Ali again for you.
Ah, yes, Purnima, as you were talking about the fact that we train people to become counselors, I remembered this student of mine who had enrolled for a counseling course, and she had a teenage son. And every now and then when mother and son used to have some fight, he would go running to the balcony and shout from there, "Ali, look at your student. Don't give her a diploma. She's shouting at me." Okay. Now, it is not that as a mother or as a counselor you have to stop shouting at your child, but even shouting is an art. You have to learn how to do that. We'll teach you if you are interested. Okay, can we have a session for those who still did not finish their exams and waiting to give exams and then completely frustrated now for them? Yes, Leela, thanks for that suggestion. I think we'll take that into account and we'll announce how it is over here now. I am waiting for more questions to come in, and while that is going on, Let me also tell you, particularly since Leela has pointed this thing out, one is that Purnima just now told you that we are there to help you at an individual level, because every child has a different learning style. Some children are visual, some are auditory, some are experiential, some are tactile. So we even take children through that on a one-to-one basis or in small groups of two or three or something. That is what we are there, and we will help you with that. Or you can take some tips from us. There's this little practical book that I've written on study skills. You can take a copy of that, and you yourself as a parent can let the child go through those things. Simple techniques like this mind mapping and these sort of things, which you can make the child do, particularly if the child is facing some important exam or something of that sort in the coming few days. Pooja says some things that have been made lockdown easier for younger kids, especially taking time out to rearrange our home spaces to facilitate learning for the kids, identifying spaces or nooks, a nook for where the children to go when they are bored, confused, need attention. Yes, these are the type of things that I've been talking about. I'm glad Pooja is sharing that with us. A soft nook in the bedroom, throw some pillows, few favorite books, a cuddle me soft toy, etc. Similarly, identifying more such spaces for kids and things of that sort.
Ali, Rachita is asking, children are locked up in the house all day.
Yes.
As a child who loves to go out and explore, how does one make them understand social distancing and lock up in the apartment?
Yes. First, ask yourself, what do you believe in, how convinced you are, and what is the threat, and these sort of things. I think we need to do a little more self-introspection before we convince. Because as you know very well, that only when you are convinced, you can convince somebody else about whatever you are feeling. So how strongly do you feel about that? And then you explain to the child. If you agree that this is not whatever I've told you in the beginning of this session, that this is not a natural thing for the child, can you empathize with your child and say, yes, I'm also very angry with this so-called COVID. It has such a stupid thing. It has locked you in and things of that sort. So become a team with the child, so that you can. Now Surekha has asked, how can we motivate a child who is resistant to online learning? I mean, if a child is not resistant to online learning, I would be a little worried. Why does he want to stick to the screen? Probably he's using that as a means to do some other funny stuff or something of that sort. But yes, they are going to be resistant. I told you, tell them that I am also unhappy. I would like you to go to school. I'd like you to jump around, play with your friends. But right now, this is the thing. Can you please help me? Can you please cooperate so that we get, they feel angry about our trying to restrict the TV and games time, as they are already doing a laptop school session. Yes, very natural. Empathize with them, work with them, help them to understand, give them alternatives, do some activities with them. And if it is possible to step out of your apartment, that is the best thing. If you can go to the terrace, if you can go to the garden, if you can go to a neighbor's house, I don't know. I leave it to you what you want to do and what you don't want to do. But I think children should have that, stepping out and things like that. Habits have gone haywire, says Aznas. Exactly unaware when school will start. Sleeping habits have gone erratic, as they would love to sleep when parents sleep. So is it okay to let them be, or should some habits be just the same? When you said that they want to sleep when parents sleep, I come back to the age-old thing that children are very poor at listening to their parents. They are very good at mimicking them. What sort of role model are you? If you finish for the day and sit down in the night watching a Netflix movie which goes on till 1 o'clock in the night, don't expect your child to go to sleep at 9:30. Somewhere we have to be a good role model. We have to involve them in whatever the activities are, and these activities should be what I mentioned to you earlier. Radha says, I'm not able to motivate my son studying in 10th standard to do some physical activity, as he has got used to be at home. I have no other issues regarding him except this fitness. Start off with role modeling. You start doing some physical activity, get somebody else, get your husband to do it, and let it slowly become a team type of thing. Carrot and stick policy. If you do this, I will sit and play a game with you or something. The reward should always be non-material. Okay? give your child some non-material rewards for that, and be a little strict, saying that, sorry, if you are not going to listen to me, I know how important physical activity is, but if you are not going to do that, then I will have to put some restrictions on you, or I will have to discipline you in some other areas. Navanita said, children are now engaged to screen as all kinds of classes are conducted online. Sometimes they are getting frustrated. How to help them, especially when they are in their teenage? Yes, obviously. That's what I have been saying, that I am not in favor of children spending hours and hours. Firstly, talk it over with your school. Can you reduce that? Can you find some alternatives? Can you find some other ways of the child learning instead of from morning to evening, one of the period after another, just sticking to the thing? If the school doesn't cooperate, then you see what are the alternatives that can be done. Can you develop some alternative, some sort of things, particularly as you said, when they are teenagers, they've got so much of both mental and physical energy which is untapped and which has to, you know, come out in various different ways. These are the for very young children. Meena says, kitchen is the best and interesting activity area. Teaching and learning happens without any effort. Yes, Meena, I agree with you. But then again, you know, it boils down to the same thing. Are you making it a positive thing? Hey guys, come, let's all go and enjoy ourselves. Let's make something nice. Hey, see this aroma of this thing coming out. You wanted this particular thing, you know. If you just chop this vegetable for me, then I can do this. I can produce something. Praise the child. When everybody is sitting down on the, you know, lunch or dinner table, tell the some elders in the house or some relative or somebody, you know, this is what my child did. Maybe take a photo. That's a lot of people are used to doing that, no? Take a photo of what is there on the table and send it to your relatives and say that, see, my son helped me in chopping the vegetables for this and that sort of thing. So before lockdown, my son used to get up at 5 a.m. on his own and go for football coaching. After lockdown, he never wants to, go out, but he is
sticking
to online games. Yes. My question to you is, are you providing him with an alternative? You cannot, you know, send him for football coaching, but there should be something. I can't tell you individually, it depends on where you live, which is your environment, what you are, you as a parent, how much you are allowing your child to go out. I know of parents who are encouraging their children to take part in sport activities in protected environment, in places where they know that the child is safe and where there are just a restricted number of known people over there who will also take care of the child the same way as I'm taking care of my child. But please explore the thing. In fact, somebody had mentioned about getting up in the morning. One of the best, most traditional and most useful things that a child can do, if you have a balcony or a terrace and if you can watch the sunrise, doing something equivalent to a Surya Namaskar, to be able to get that vitamin D of the early morning sunlight, to be able to feel that cool breeze on your face. The same thing happens at sunset. I don't know how many of you have been observing the full moon which has been there for the last 2 days. Did you go into an open area, a terrace, a balcony in the last 2 days and told your child, come, this is full moon time, let the moon rise and we'll sit and watch it? These are small things, but this is what makes a difference. Navina says, wanted to share that my son is so desperate to go to school. I really empathize with him. How did it disappear?
Okay, Ali, in the meantime, I experience emotional outbursts of our child due to regular head-ons with the father over sincerity over high school studies, where she is negotiating to see her grandparents who stay in the same city. She just wants to go spend a night with them. Father is living so much in the COVID fear. I don't know how to deal with this.
I wish I had some pill or some magic wand by which I could give to the wives, you know, put this in the coffee of your husband and now he will change his behavior. No. This, as I told you, we are talking long term. We are not talking about whether the child goes to the grandparents' house or not. What you are talking about is the short term thing. I want you to understand that if your child is going to be deprived of, let's say, extended family like grandparents and other relatives, there may be, you may be having a brother, sister living in another city whom you used to meet very frequently, but now it doesn't look like you're going to meet them at all for a very, very long time to come. Neither you will go nor they will come. All these I want you to please look into the long-term perspective, okay? Naveena's question that I want to share, that my son is so desperate to go to school. He says, when will the school reopen? Now with your session, I realize why he wants it so much. Also, the other day, without my knowledge, my son went to the president of my apartment while walking and asked him, when will they be allowed to play? Wonderful. I think one day your son will become the president, not only of your society, but maybe president of India. And I came to know, I actually felt happy about it that he could do that. Yes, this is exactly what I have been telling you about life skills, about social and emotional development. If today he can go to the president of the society and ask him this politely but firmly, tomorrow he can ask for whatever he wants and he will get it. This is a very simple thing, but this is what I mean by saying that this is what you need to help your child to develop. This is part of the learning of the child. Darnish says, I'm spending quality time with my niece in the lockdown and I'm happy to share that my creativity is improving, telling stories to her and some of my physical activities. Wonderful, Darnish. This is what I want you to understand, that sometimes if not the parent, maybe an uncle, an aunt, a domestic help, a tata, neighbor, somebody can chip in. Let's all put in our own minds and brains and do whatever little we can to help each child. Shakuntala says, I'm happy and feel blessed about my child. She attends her online
classes
for 3 hours a day and then engages herself in drawing, painting, pencil shading, playing with grandparents, chatting with me about anything that comes to her mind. Evening, playtime at the park. Wonderful, wonderful. Thanks for sharing, Shakuntala. Here you have a real life, a case of a child who is doing so much, and that's all that it needs. This is what I'm talking about, the short term. In the short term, if your child can be given all these activities and can indulge in all this, I'm extremely happy. But at the same time, I come back to the main theme of today's discussion, and that is that the child needs some planning on a long-term basis to be able to know what can be done.
Ali, there's also a question which says that we mostly end up looking at the physical development of children.
Yes.
And sometimes also the language.
Yes.
So what all are the different developments that parents can look into?
Yes. Meanwhile, Asra has given a suggestion that you should fly kites together. Yes, I got a kite for my daughter the other day and she's still learning how to fly it. If somebody can please teach her online how to fly a kite. I don't know if it's possible to teach flying kites online, but she's making desperate attempt and the kite just refuses to go up more than 2-3 feet into the air. But it's fun, going on struggling, fighting with that kite, going on, and then the dog comes and tries to bite the kite and all that goes on. This is what I meant by saying that small things, a lot can be done. Shaista said that being a teacher, I'm giving online support to my students, but nowadays my anxiety is at its peak. COVID is taking toll on my mental health. I know my comment is not connected to current situation. Doesn't matter, Shaista. If it is taking a toll, please remember it's also taking a toll on the children. When they are seeing the teacher, the mother becoming so anxious about COVID, they also will become very negative. They'll start looking at their grandparents and wondering whether they are going to die tomorrow or something of that sort. Please let us understand that things, whatever has to happen, ke sara sara, whatever will be, the future's not ours to see. But the present builds the future. Are we making those efforts to build the future? Alice says, my son is 14 years, mostly whole day he's on screen only. If I say something, he becomes rebellious. Yes, Alice, let him become rebellious. He's all of 14 years. He's entitled to be rebellious at this age. Let him become rebellious, you stick to your ground. Allow him a little bit of freedom here and there to say, okay, I don't approve of this, but since you're saying it so strongly, I will not stop you from that. But certain things I'm very clear on, I will not allow. So stick to certain things which are very important to you. And that is where you need to tell the child that this is not what I am going to respond to. Shweta says, I'm reposting my query as it got missed. I have a preteen at home who feels what to do, attend classes and then on TV.
little play in the evening.
Yeah.
So we both are getting occupied in office work and it's becoming never ending. Child is getting ignored.
Yashwata, please remember, I know your office is important. I know you may be having responsibilities of work. I know that you're looking at your future career and all that. But somewhere, it always boils down to balancing, isn't it? Is your child's future more important than your work? Can you discuss it with your bosses and say that, no, since this lockdown has come, my child is at home, I need more time with my child, I don't care if you don't give me that next promotion or give me excellent this thing, but I will work for you, I will do my duties, but I also need to balance it by, you know, spending some quality time with my child. These are some of the things that, you know, you have to take a call. I'm sorry that I am telling you what to do. It's after all your life, your job, your family, all these things. There are so many factors to that. I'm sure you have to take all that into account. But somewhere, basically, when we are talking about children, we have to understand that children deserve as much time and attention of yours as your work or your profession or your boss, however nice he is to you.
There's a question
yeah.
by Mr. Basu Patan. He says that my son attends online classes, but it's becoming very difficult to monitor if he's engaged in something else or a parallel window or a laptop. If we try looking at his screen, he gets annoyed.
Correct. One thing is, I always believe that policing never helps, you know, in good upbringing of your child. Somewhere we have to help him to understand. And that starts with this thing called empathy, as I told you. If you can sit with him sometime and say that, are you enjoying? And if he says, no, these are stupid classes, I'm getting bored of it. And look at that idiotic teacher, you know, how she teaches. I can't even understand her accent or something of that sort. Go along with the child for the moment. Allow the child to come out with his feelings, his frustration. And then reinforce back to the child why it is important. With the hope that I am looking to see whether this can be reduced, this can be, you know, some time limit can be set so that we can move on to a better days in life. I can assure you that the rest of your, you know, growing up years, you're not going to be sitting in front of the laptop. But for the time being, since it has to be done, how do we move that? I don't want to police you. I don't want to keep peeping over your shoulder. I want to love you and trust you. But please come up to your trust. Come and tell me when you're frustrated. Come and tell me when you're opening another, window and doing something else. It happens once in a while. But then how do you get back to it and what is the significance of this thing? And why is it important as a temporary measure? Yes, I don't have the question.
Yes, so Rinku says that my daughter is 12 years old and started closing her room every time she gets irritated. Is it right? She never used to do this earlier.
Yeah.
Earlier, I used to think it's just a tantrum, but it's becoming a habit, I think.
Correct.
She talks to me about everything, but I don't know how I can handle this.
Can do that. Instead of banging on the door or forcing her to keep the door open, as I've mentioned earlier, first ask her. At that moment, she has locked the door and she's in a very nasty mood. Let it go. Sometime later, she will come out. When she's in a good mood and she's talking nicely to you, you say that, you know, at 12 o'clock when we had that argument or when you were talking, you just ran off to your room and you locked the door. I didn't come banging the door or I didn't question you or something because I thought, yeah, maybe you want your privacy and you want to let off steam and all that. But can you tell me what happened? I was angry. You said this to me, whatever it is the child will say. Then you say, yes, you have a right to be angry. Anger comes from within. I'm not stopping you from getting angry, but are there ways and means of doing it? You know, with me, it's okay. I'm your mom. I'm your dad. You lock the door also. I'm not going to be. But tomorrow, will you be able to do that in the days to come? You may not be able to do it. You cannot run away. Isn't locking the door a means of running away from reality? Would you like to run away from reality or would you like to face? So how would you like to face the situation? Come, let's sit and talk about alternatives to bring out your anger and frustration. Next.
When my child who is 10 years old shares her difficulties with friends and teachers, like, ma'am hits me when I do a mistake, she is partial and I don't want to go change my class, I understand it isn't easy. She feels ashamed and also alienated at times.
Yes. All you need to do is to hear her out firstly, empathize with her, help her to manage her emotions, identify what those emotions are. Is she feeling ashamed? Is she feeling guilty? Is she feeling rage? Is she feeling irritated? Work on those, the management of the emotions, and then move on to the empathy factor. Why does so-and-so teacher behave like this, whereas some other teacher behaves like that? Why does one classmate of yours is so nice to you, another classmate is not very nice to you? Teach her how to get along with all the people in her life, be it teachers, be it extended family, be it her best friends or anybody like that. I think we are moving to the end of the program. Let us have the last one or two questions and then we will wind up. But this is not the end. As Purnima told you, one is you can always get back to us anytime. We are working full time, including we have started working half days on Sundays, because some people, you know, are free only on Sundays. So even on Sundays, half a day we are working. The other 6 days of the week we are working fully. So you can talk to us on the phone, you can come over and visit us, or you can send us an email. We'll continue to do that. And then next Saturday when we meet, we will be talking about the needs, you know, the emotional needs, the special needs of children who sometimes get into, some of those have been mentioned today also, that have given me some food for thought. I will include that in the next Saturday's program. So what are the last questions, Seema?
Only child question. Right. I'm not sure if I should ask this here, but lockdown is also causing adults to argue and fight. Kids are the audience to this fight between the parents, and they have nowhere else to go. How can I help?
If you can avoid the argument, that will be wonderful. If circumstances are such that you lose your temper and you cannot really control your emotions, get over with the argument. Go to your child and say, were you disturbed? Were you afraid when mommy and daddy were shouting at each other? Do you feel insecure? Maybe hug your child or pull your child close and put your arm around and say, don't worry, we keep fighting, we also become friends. And however much we may fight, both of us love you immensely. You are the most important person in our life. So giving that little reassurance to the child is enough, even if you cannot stop yourself from fighting or arguing. These are the type of things which, again, we'll continue discussion next Saturday. That now this child, let's say, becomes emotionally disturbed because parents are fighting. The child may have some special needs. The child may go through a lot of agony if somebody is not well or somebody is not behaving properly. All these needs we'll look into next Saturday at 11 o'clock. In the meanwhile, we are there for you. As I told you, please feel free to come. If you want to become a counselor yourself, we are now enrolling people for the next program, our Diploma in Counseling Skills. Come and have a chat with us. Whatever we can do to help you in whatever possible manner, let's create a better world out there. COVID-19 will go away in no time. You know the proverb, no? This too shall pass. COVID shall pass, lockdown shall pass, but life will go on, children will grow up. Let's look to ensure that children grow up to become much better, healthier, more capable and more balanced adults. That's the greatest service that we can do to the next generation. Go ahead, do it, and enjoy the process at the same time. Good day to all of you. Jai Hind.
There may be a few questions which possibly may have, you know, not been addressed by us, but then we'll ensure that, you know, and we'll take Dr. Ali's tips on those questions and reply back to you, as we have been doing, you know, every Saturday. And continuing this would be our next session next Saturday, which is, you know, addressing the emotional and special needs of children. And the person who has brought this all, everything together, tied it, streamed it together, is Seema. And I will now pass this on to Seema.
Thank you so much, Purni and Ali. And please like our Facebook page, because we will be updating you with all the new courses and everything that we are coming up with. And also, this video is available. It is recorded and it is on our Facebook page. So you can forward it or share it with the people who think, you know, you think will benefit from this. And we are open Saturday till Saturday, Monday to Saturday from 9 to 5:30. Please call us and
on
you're
Sunday
most welcome.
From 9
and
to
Sunday also, we are working from 9 to 1 o'clock. So please come over and we are all there for you. Thank you so much. Have a great day.
Okay. One more. Over. Now next
Saturday, we should tell them about the third Thursday talk.